Hello everyone, Jacques Dupré from Mortgage Allies. A great evening to you. I am so pleased that you have joined our webinar tonight. I'm going to talk about budgeting. Now, I've done a series of articles, which I'll show you a little bit later on, about getting out of debt. So I'm going to not going to go into too much depth into that one. I'm going to talk about what you need to know about your credit. Now, this topic is probably the biggest black box for people ever. I do the seminar. I literally can do 9 hours on that topic, no problem. But it is such a black box topic where people, it's hard to believe that in our world today, that people don't know how their credit works and what is required for them to get the best mortgage out there. If you think about it, it is one of the fundamental things that you need to apply for a loan, and yet that information is held so tightly to financial institutions. It's not fair. But I'm going to walk through this with you, and then definitely, and we're going to stop and talk about getting mortgage free faster. That is one of my, actually, all three of these topics are my favorites. But the mortgage free topic is amazing, and it's something I'm going to share with you guys as well about that we're rolling out for you. All right, so let's jump right in. So budgeting, I make no secret of it that I follow this gentleman here, Dave Ramsey. He is, I believe, a $13 million following in the United States. He has helped many, many, many people out of debt. And Dave says, you have got to tell your money where to go or else it will leave. And it is exactly that. You leave money around in a bank account without putting in a budget, guess what? You're going to come back, what? There's only this much left? And literally that is what happens, okay? So we believe in what's called a zero-based budget. But now the details are important. In other words, we say that income minus outgoing items. Notice I didn't say expenses. I said outgoing items equal zero. What we mean with this is that the things that come out of your bank account should not just be expenses, right? Because we don't want to have zero money at the left over at the end of the year. So in the budget, you'll see the second, what we created for you is we allow things like an emergency fund, investments, all those things that should go out of your bank account, but into other buckets, into your financial planners, buckets so they can plan for you, et cetera, et cetera. But a budget is absolutely important. Without a budget, you literally, it's like going on a destination to nowhere. Your money will just come out every month and you will have no money left over. And we are classic as human beings. We earn this much money and we're concerned that we have to low. Then we earn this much money and we still use all of it. And then when you use this much money, we still use all of it. And it's because we don't have a budget. And I have lots of empathy for it. You'll see about, in the end about that as well. So we have a budget for you. So if you go and scan right here, that's going to take you to our website. And Nadia has created an awesome budget for you. You can actually download it and use it offline as well. Put your numbers in it. It'll tell you when your budget is balanced. So please go ahead and do that. Of course, you don't have to use that one. You can use a simple Excel sheet. I believe even in the Excel templates that are available, you can just create a download a budget template. I believe ours is very comprehensive. It has a lot of categories that you don't normally see with other budgets. And so use that. Obviously, there are things like Mint and Dave Ramsey's Every Dollar. Those are apps that are really good. What I really like, I don't get a cent from it, so don't worry about that. What I really like about Dave Ramsey's Every Dollar is that it is based on the envelope system. A normal budget does not stop you from spending. It only tells you what you have spent. You should have a budgeting system that it stops you from spending. And I believe Every Dollar does that really, really well. So go check it out, all right? They have an app and I believe a web-based as well. All right, so second thing we want to talk about is what is my maximum property purchase price? This is an incredibly important thing. So when we create, the reason why I put this in budgeting, you're wondering like, what has this got to do with budgeting? It's really important And it's got everything to do with budgets, because when we qualify somebody for a mortgage, we only use the total debt service and gross debt service ratios. Now, inside these ratios, we only have the mortgage payments, and we take any HEAT amount that the lender gives us. We add the property taxes to that. We add condo fees to that. And we add other debts to that. Okay. That is the only stuff that goes into the calculation. Well, you know, if you're a real person like me, you're like, so what happened to groceries? What happened to my, you know, entertainment budget? What happened to clothes? What happened to daycare? None of that stuff goes in there. And so under this formula, the government says you can use up to 44% of your gross income to buy a house. Well, if it's 44%, go imagine that. Imagine you pay as your gross income before tax income. Imagine adding 35% taxes onto that. You're up to 79% of your income is completely used. You only have 21% to live on. Okay. And so what you really want to do before you talk to anybody about a mortgage is you want to do your budget, because your budget is going to tell you what you can spend on your mortgage. And if you're really on top of your game, you'll probably shock your mortgage provider. You should go to your mortgage provider and say, hey, Jacques, mortgage broker, I would like you to arrange a mortgage for me, please, but I don't want to spend more than $1,950 on my mortgage a month, okay? That means you're not worrying about what you qualify for, you are worrying about what you can afford. Your budget tells you what you can afford, the government tells you what you can qualify for. They're very different things from each other, all right? Hopefully that helps you there. All right, so the next thing is a lot of people ask me, well, should I have no debt before purchasing a home? That's one thing I disagree with Dave Ramsey in the United States. You know, in the United States, good luck to you. You could buy a house for $250,000, probably less. Well, in the GTA, not so much. All right, good luck to you. I mean, I got young people that are getting really angry right now saying, I earn $85,000 and I cannot buy a house for more than $400,000. That's crazy. And you can't even find it, right? So, you know, Dave Ramsey says you should be debt-free and try to buy your house cash or be no more than 15 years. Well, I love Dave, but it's not Canada. I mean, you cannot buy a house in Canada for those kind of prices, or certainly in the GTA. So here's what I tell you is this: try your best to be out of debt as much as possible. Also remember that CMHC, the mortgage insurers, will tell us that in the first 18 months after you bought a house, you will probably spend up to $10,000 to $15,000 on that house, right? So you don't want to go into credit card for that. Also important to know that as soon as your debt payments, like credit cards, car payments, all that kind of stuff, is more than 5% of your monthly income, it will start to affect how much mortgage you can qualify for. Now, I know I just unloaded a whole mouthful of information there on you. But if you need more clarification on that, please chat with me. Here's how you can pay off debt. There are a myriad ways of paying off debt. People will tell you that you should pay the highest interest one first, and there's a whole bunch of range. I believe in this system. It's called the total debt snowball plan. Now, here's another freebie for you, 100% free. You can download that file. It is really clever. You enter your debts in, it'll even arrange it for you in which way you should pay it off first. How's that? 100% free, okay? The debt snowball plan in a very short sentence works like this. You take the smallest debt first, okay? And let's just say that minimum payment is $100. You up that $100 by whatever your budget allows you, maybe $50. So now you pay $150 on that one. You pay it off. Once you pay that one, if you take that $150, because you already used to paying that off, now you're adding it to the second smallest one, because you already paid the smallest off. The second smallest one. So let's just say the second smallest is $100. You take the $100 from the second smallest, plus the $150 you've already been used to, it becomes $250. And you keep on going until your debt pays off. Now here's the cool thing about it. Lots of benefits to it. One of the things is you win quickly. The reason why I don't recommend paying the highest interest one off first, because, well, if you've got a $20,000 loan to pay off at 15%, you're going to get tired by month four and you're going to stop, okay? Where if you have a small one to pay off, it's a quick win, you get encouraged in the process, okay? Second benefit of it is you learn lessons as you go along the line. You learn to tighten your finances. So by the time you've paid it all off, you've learned a ton of lessons, right? Third benefit, guess what? When you've paid it off, and let's just say you're used to paying $1,500 a month on debt, you've got $1,500 a month that you can do stuff with. You can invest it. You can say, hey, I want to buy a rental property. Because guess what? $1,500 a month, it's an example, but that's like a mortgage payment on a rental property, right? So the total debt snowball is a wonderful, wonderful way to pay off your debt fast, okay? So you can see, just you just scan it. Now it's been great. She's created these scans for you. It'll take you through to those sites. Now, here's the thing I said I was going to talk to you about. Understand this, okay? Budgeting is hard, all right? My family know when I do my budget or when I do my staff's payroll, they disappear because it's not my favorite topic. It's not my favorite thing to do either. And here I'm talking about it tonight, okay? It's hard. It's as hard as going to the gym, all right? It's as hard as doing the right thing. But if you stop, you'll pay the price. Keep your foot in the door. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it, okay? You can do this. It's hard for me. I don't like this part of financing, but it is an important thing for you to do, right? Hopefully you learned a lot from me. As I said, these are vast, vast topics. I'm trying to just whet your appetite and also give you these free resources. So here, let's talk about credit, all right? So the amount of people who come to me and absolutely have no understanding what their credit score is, how their credit works, whether they are barely qualifying for a mortgage or whether they are top of the line is unbelievable, okay? Credit is that important. It is one of the top five pillars that determines whether you can get a mortgage or not. Now, I'm going to put it to you this way. In some cases, credit is even more important than income because in some cases, I can get you a mortgage without much income, but I cannot get you a good mortgage without very good credit. Make sense? So it's really, really important for us to talk to. Again, big topics here, but let's talk about credit scores. There are essentially two credit bureaus in Canada, TransUnion and Equifax. These are public companies. They don't belong to the government. They are not government-based at all. Your credit score ranges between 300 and 900. All right. And since the government, since 2016, since the government has kind of shaken up their mortgage rules for the millionth time, it is not even clear in many ways what your minimum credit score should be. So if your mortgage is insured, I'm not trying to be technical here, then your mortgage, your credit score can be as low as 600. But if it's not insured anymore, some lenders even require a 700 or 720 credit score. So as a general rule, you want to keep your credit score at 720 and above. That means you'll be eligible for any mortgage product that's out there, okay? Now, let me say this about something. I've talked about, I don't get a single cent of, I pay these people a lot of money, actually, Equifax and TransUnion. There are many free credit reports out there, all right? As much as they're great and they're trying to do a wonderful thing for people, they really are not worth anything when it comes to actual lending, okay? When it comes to lending also, you cannot check your own credit score. You can check it, but we cannot use that credit report. Your credit for lending purposes must be done by an accredited third party, such as a mortgage broker, all right? That's important because a lot of people say, can I not just give you my credit report? No, I can't do that, unfortunately, all right? Let's talk about diversity. So you need to diversify your credit over time, all right? So that means, what does that mean? You want to have a line of credit. Let me just stop the bus for a second. I am debt adverse. Less is way more than better for me, okay? And if I didn't have to have credit, I would not have credit, okay? But in our world today, you need credit. And since you need credits to be able to get a mortgage, you want to diversify your credit. So you want to have a line of credit. You want to have a Visa. Now, again, if your philosophy as a family says, no, I don't want to have a lot of it, then don't violate your conscience, okay? But it's important for you to know you need a line of credit, a Visa. And so we're looking for normally two facilities, okay? A facility is a credit card, okay? For each 2 years old or one facility for at least 5 years old. But having one is dangerous. If you make one mistake on that one, it's really going to hurt you a lot. Now, car payments do build or break your credit. The reason why I say don't depend on a car loan to build your credit is because guess what? You're eventually going to pay it off and it's going to collapse, right? So there's no point in depending on that credit facility to build your credit, right? Beware of cell phone bills. I'm not picking on any specific cell phone company here. They are famous for damaging people's credit. The other thing important for you to note is if I have a buddy, we go out on a Saturday night for a beer and he buys me a beer. And you know what? He bought me one more than I bought him. I'm not going to lie sleeplessly awake at night, you know, because he owes me $6 I'm not going to do that. But your credit company, your lending company, if you own 1 cent on your credit card and you do not pay it back, your credit will be hit. It will be damaged. Okay. So make sure that thing is paid off every single month in full. Okay. Let's talk about maturity. That's what I was talking about here. You want to have the older, the better. So if you get a Visa that you opened in 2001, that is very powerful. Okay. And beware of this. Sometimes banks will say, look, Jacques, that old Visa you have, look, we've got a much better product. Let's get you a new Visa. Don't do it, because that old Visa, that is building your credit like crazy. Okay. So keep it as much as you can. All right. The other thing to remember is balances versus credit limit. So let's just say your Visa has a credit limit of 10. What should your balance be? All right. Your balances should be no more than 35% of the overall credit. So if you've got a Visa of 5,000, a line of credit of 10, that's a total credit of $15,000. Your balances should be no more than 5,250, which is 35%. Don't check my math on that now, okay? It should be no more than 35% of the limit. If you go above that, it'll start eroding your credit score. All right? Awesome. And this is an important thing for us to understand. So how many credit checks should you allow? As little as possible. But there are lots and lots of myths surrounding that. People like to say, don't check my credit. It's going to damage my credit. That's not true. Okay. If you've got strong credit, your credit will not even, your score will not even drop. Okay. And if it does drop, it'll recover itself in no time. Now, if you've got bad credit, yes, be very careful of that. Okay. And also, it's important for you to know this. If somebody comes to get a mortgage and they go, Jacques, can you look for a mortgage for me? But I don't want you to check my credit. I go, it's like, I can't do it. I just, you know, we can give each other a hug or have a coffee, but I can't get you a mortgage. Right? Because I have to be able to check your credit. So a lot of people say, oh, please don't check my credit. And I'm like, well, I can't help you then. I have to be able to check your, to assess your eligibility for a mortgage, I need to be able to check your credit. Okay? So that's important to, so instead of saying people not to check your credit, be selective who you allow to check your credit. All right? Awesome. Derogatory is pretty straightforward. Be very careful to pay all your debts off every month if you can. If you cannot, then pay at least the minimum payments. But I want to give you a bit of a tip here, okay? There are, because it's, I mean, I'm in the industry, and even for me, it's not always clear what banks will do with credit, okay? So here's an example. You heard from a friend of yours that there's a better Visa rate out there, okay? Or somebody in the family gets sick, and you go to the bank and say, look, we've just got a bit of a family emergency here. Can you just like, just drop my payments a little bit lower until we get back on our feet and then we'll be good. And the bank says, oh, absolutely, no problem. Well, you go away, next time you check your credit, it's like, what? They put a credit counseling note on my credit report. Like, that's now damaged my credit a lot. So here's the thing, a very important tip. If you ever talk to your financial institution or your credit card company and you say, or your mortgage company and say, listen, we just got this situation, or can you drop my rate? You always, always, always wanna ask this question. Is this going to affect my credit? And will you report something negative to the credit bureau about what I just asked you to do? Okay. And make sure you get that, because then they have to be rather firm for you. And very often, actually, I'm not trying to be funny, the person will look at you like you have 15 heads because they would not know the answer to that. But it's important that you get a very clear and direct answer about that. Okay. Great. So consent, this is a big deal for me. every institution that wants or needs to check your credit must get your consent in writing before they check your credit. Now, beware of the small print, especially with banks. The small print, it says they can check your credit whenever they want to, okay? Make sure you make it very clear to them that you want your credit to be checked only when you've given written consent, all right? Manage your credit. I cannot spend more enough time on this. So manage your credit, people are like, yeah, okay, just go check my credit every year. Yeah, that is part of it. So what you want to do is when you go to Equifax, you can, if you do the free report, it does not have your score on it. You can actually pay for a report and you get one that has your score on it, okay? They have another program. I think it's $13 a month. You subscribe, whenever somebody checks your credit, you'll actually get an email saying somebody checked your credit. So it's very proactive, okay? But there's another element to it that you really need to be proactive about. It is this. So you go and buy the car, and 5 years down the road, you're done, you paid the car off, and you call car company X and say, hey, or bank X with the car loan and say, I paid my car loan off, and boom, you forget about it. That's not where you should stop. You should go to that bank or car company who lends you the money and say, listen, I want you to write, give it to me in writing, that the balance of the loan is zero, and that you have reported back to the credit bureau to update my credit report. You definitely want to do that because there is no accountability on the credit card company or on the loan company to report once you paid it off. They will keep on reporting when you owe the money because it's in their best interest, right? But once you paid them off, they're kind of like, well, there's no more incentive for me to report. And that's where you need to keep them accountable to make sure that they report accurately that loan is paid off. And normally if you do that, it'll say paid off by consumer's request. It'll say something like that, okay? And that way, when you do that, you have that letter on file, you'll know whatever you see in your credit report is real data. It's not, oh my goodness, I didn't know this about, okay? Cool? An important thing also that I see with clients is I show them their credit reports. Your bank won't even show you a credit report. Isn't it ridiculous? I'll show you a credit report. But clients will say, no. My Visa balance is not $3,200 anymore. I paid it off yesterday. And they're probably right. Because guess what? It's not a real-time document. It updates only once a month. And not every credit facility updates on the same day either. So it's all over the place. All right, number 10. What is the minimum information that somebody like me needs to check your credit? I need the following. I need your legal names, first and last name. I need your date of birth, and I need your address. So what's missing out of that picture? Your SIN number, okay? I don't legally need anybody's SIN number to check their credit. But here's the problem. If your name is John Smith, and there's normally quite a few John Smiths in this world, and there's another John Smith, I may have your identities crossed over. And if the other John Smith has bad credit and you don't, it's going to be a nightmare to try and separate those two. That's the first reason why we ask for the SIN number. The second reason why is even though a borrower has no legal obligation to give a lender their SIN number, equally a lender has no legal obligation to give somebody a loan without having their SIN number. Okay? So all of the lenders out there will insist on having somebody's SIN number before they assess their eligibility for a loan. So it's kind of a bit of a catch-22. And it's sad for me because every government documentation you read will say, don't give your SIN number to anybody to check your credit. And I'm like, it's not helpful because people then don't want to give you SIN numbers, but the other side of the story, the government doesn't share with them. And so you obviously want to make sure you know the people that you give your information to. Referrals particularly are really, really important because then you know it comes with a trusted source, okay? I think I've said enough about that. Now, here's a weird thing, number 11, okay? I cannot give you a copy of your own credit report. You can go get it yourself from Equifax, but I cannot give you a copy of your own credit report that I may even show to you, okay? And that is because we have terms and conditions with Equifax and TransUnion that make us members, and it says a member cannot give a non-member a copy. It's because what people forget is Equifax and TransUnion are actually commercial companies. We pay quite a bit of money for every report we check. And so they obviously try and protect that revenue source and their IP. So it's so sad. People always have, can you please send me a copy of my credit report? I actually go through my clients' reports with them when we meet. When we can't. So we actually get in serious trouble if we do. In fact, we can lose our license when you do that. All right. Another little tip, if you know your credit score, you can be way more, I don't want to say aggressive, I don't want to say demanding, but you can stand your ground with a bank who says you can't get X or you can't get Y. All right. So it's very, if you get informed about this, really, really powerful for you. Right. Let's jump into this topic. I absolutely love this topic. You know why? Because, let me just line it up properly here. Because so few Canadians become mortgage free faster. Now take a guess. How many Canadians actually get mortgage free faster? There you have it. Only 1%. And that's a travesty. It should never be like that. And let me give you a slogan that one of our banks has. We have great banks in Canada. We do. Okay. Their slogan goes like this. Don't own a mortgage, own a home. That really is inspiring. I'm not being facetious when I say it. It's very inspiring to me, okay? Except here's the problem. I could say to you, climb Mount Everest, but if I don't buy the backpack, we don't do the training, and we don't book the flight, you're probably not gonna climb Mount Everest. And it just dies in inspiration. There's no reality to it, okay? And so it's important for us that you pay off your mortgage faster because you get better off. And so now, where is the problem? Why is it that we don't pay our mortgages off faster? So people say, we need information. It's because we have too little information. Well, if you Google search mortgage free today, this is not a joke. I checked it last night again. You will get 562 million hits how to become mortgage free faster, or the topic of mortgage free, okay? So I don't think there is a lack of information. We are literally drowning information. So why is it that we are not paying our mortgages off faster than what we can, okay? So I'm going to be so cocky as to stick out my neck and say there may be five reasons or even more that prevent us from paying our mortgage off faster. I'm gonna say some things that are, I've learned from experience. They are not meant to be discrediting anybody. They are not meant to be putting anybody in a bad light. I use no names here, but I wanna be frank with you when I say this, okay? So the first thing we wanna consider is the philosophies of the lender. These things are so obvious, but they are not necessarily common sense, okay? Here's why the philosophy of the lender is really important to you. If my philosophy as a bank is to make profit, okay? How do I make profit as a bank? I make profit from a bank, as a bank, by selling debt to people like you and me. And I make profit from taking your deposits and lending out to other people at a profit. Okay, so what? There's nothing new about that, Jacques. The only problem is this, is if I get richer by selling you more debt, well, then you're not getting richer. In other words, my goals say I must sell you more debt. Your goal says I should not have debt. So guess what? I am in conflict of interest with you as a bank, okay? Or as a lending institution for that matter, okay? And so means the nicest people could be working at these institutions. I could be having a glass of wine with them every single Friday, okay? The point is the philosophy of making debt out of making profit when we sell debt to people. In other words, not because the people are evil, it's because of the business model. We should really be cognizant of that. We should fully understand that whenever they sell debt, it's to benefit themselves and we lose. It's a bit like I use this ridiculous example. You go sign up for a gym to get in shape, and you sit, you sign a contract and you get a coach. all right? And you go like, wow, that's amazing. But after 3 months, you're like, I'm in worse shape than what I started. And you figure out like, and you find out that your coach actually get a bonus from you getting more out of shape. What would you say? You're like, this is nuts. Like, I would never do that. I would never consciously sign up for that. So again, nicest people, but you need to understand their goals are very different to your goals. Okay. Important for you to know that. Okay. So another reason why we don't pay for mortgages first, because information is not transformation. Okay. And so it's just because we know the information, it doesn't mean we do anything with it. And so life is busy. Life is crazy. Very often we don't do the things that we said we would do. And what people also forget to understand is that finances, like weight loss, like exercise, have very little to do with information. It is everything to do with behavior. Okay. So the sooner we realize that we need to look at our behavior, our habits, that's probably when it's going to start to, we're going to start to pay attention to pay our mortgages off faster. Okay. So it's not an information issue. It's 570 million hits to pay your mortgage off faster. Okay. But we don't do it because we're busy, busy people. Okay. The next thing I want to talk about is the wrong focus. So let me put it this way. My favorite question to ask is, which pair of shoes is the most expensive shoe? It's a bit of a trick question, but bear with me. So you go to the local shoe store, and there's one pair of shoes, looks like it's got leather uppers, nice, $150. And then the sales guy takes you to another shelf, and he shows another pair of shoes, leather shoes, and those are $650. So which shoe is the most expensive shoe? And guess what 95% of people do? They say the $150 shoe is the least expensive, and they simply cannot afford the 650 pair of shoe. I'm not trying to sell you expensive shoes, I promise you, okay? The principle is this. If you evaluate the shoe by its sticker price, okay? Now it's what it costs you up front. This is the cheaper shoe, not that. But that's not how life works. If we evaluate, and we should evaluate something by its life cycle, in other words, 20 years down the road, which is the cheaper shoe? Okay, well, the $650 shoe, not thousands of shoes, is they are resellable. As they get older, guess what happens? They even wear better, they're nicer. And then these ones, typically 2 to 3 years, you have to replace them. Well, after 20 years, guess what? These are almost 3 times, if not 4 times, the price of what you would pay for those quote unquote expensive shoes up front. Okay. Well, Jacques, we didn't come here to listen to a shoe talk. You're absolutely right. You didn't. Okay. So how does this apply to mortgages? It works like this. The institutions and brokers have taught people you get a mortgage by asking about interest rates. Well, it's half the story, not even half the story, less than half the story. I tell you why. If you go to your local car dealership and you walk into the store and say, hey, sales guy, I'm looking for the cheapest car you have here. Guess what you're going to get? You are going to get the cheapest car on that lot, but it's not going to be the most suitable. It's not going to be the most reliable, and it's probably going to cost you a lot in repairs. So it's not the right question to ask. Okay. The right question rather is to go to an institution instead of just what people, most people just asking about interest rate. I find this topic so prevalent. I have people call me in the office. Okay. They'll call me off our website and they'll say, they won't even introduce themselves. They'll say, what's your rate? The first thing that comes out of their mouth is, what's your rate? And I'm like, wow. You know, in other words, what people are saying, a mortgage is a commodity, but it is not a commodity. You get led to believe that it's a commodity because if I can distract you with this up front, I can put a whole bunch of terms and conditions at back end that you don't even ask about. And yet these things are costing you a lot more than the $15 a month you could save from a mortgage, from an interest rate between the two. Okay? So you hear me getting passionate here. So the fourth one is unrealistic plans. Okay, it is great Mike Tyson that says everybody has a plan until somebody punches them in the mouth. Okay, now I know that's Iron Mike's language, but let me tell you, there's a lot of truth to that. Life happens to us, and I you know, so many of my clients that go into the mortgage and they have great ideas to pay the mortgage off faster. 5 years down the road, and they've not made any changes. It's because life happens. Especially, I see a couple buy a house, okay? And 5 years down, I talk to them again. They got two kids, and it's like life is crazy, okay? And all the great plans just got swallowed up with hockey games and, you know, ballet and all that kind of stuff. But it's important that your plans are realistic, okay? So what are the components of a realistic plan? First of all, it's got to be in writing, okay? If it's not in writing, it's a great idea. That's it. And that is the primary reason why so many of us don't achieve our intentions, okay? Write it down, all right? Second one is small changes. So many of my clients will say, man, I'm going to put $10,000 a year against my mortgage. And I go, that's great, but a small plan executed well is a whole lot better than a grandiose idealistic plan that's abandoned in disillusionment halfway. Okay, so our plan, you'll see in a second, is small changes wins the day. Because if I don't wreck your budget, that you will continue. If I impact your budget to the point where you can't live anymore, you're not going to continue, right? And so that's an important thing. Another one you were looking for is you want to have support. You definitely want to have support. If you, the stats will tell you, if somebody goes to gym and tries to get fit by themselves versus someone who gets a coach, again, I'm not working for a health club, that person who gets a coach is way, way, way better off than anybody else who's going to not get a coach, okay? Fourth one and last one is, there may be more, we just use four, is the more you can set and forget the plan, the better. What set and forget I mean is if you can make a change, don't have to revisit that change every week or every month or whatever. The likelihood that you will get that done is going to be much better than not than somebody than trying to having to figure out every single month how you're going to pay off your mortgage. Okay, so a lack of support. I've kind of talked a lot about that already. If the reality is, the more we do it with somebody, we get support for doing something, the likelihood is we're going to get it done. All right, so let's chat about this. Okay, so here we go. Talk is cheap, right? Jacques, you've got all these things to say about everybody else. Well, what do you do, right? And so it's important for you to understand, we have a different profitability model. The reason why I became a mortgage broker is because I am never or almost never, unless somebody's got bad credits, in my clients' pockets. I get paid by the bank, okay? I don't get a single cent of the interest that you pay. I don't. So if you're mortgage-free tomorrow, 20 months from today, or 30 years, I don't get a single cent of that mortgage, okay? And so I believe, actually, it is very profitable for my brokerage and for my team for you to get mortgage-free faster. Why? I get a lot of friends and a lot of advocates that love us because we just saved them $80,000 to $100,000 over the life of their mortgage. Okay. And those people, those advocates are our clients. They refer their friends, and it becomes a community who inspire each other to pay the mortgage faster. So we are, in that sense, I'm in a very privileged position. I get to add love to you, help you pay off your mortgage, and I'm not in your pocket. Okay. And so my goals are your goals. When you win, we win. That's right. There's no conflict of interest between goals. That's why I love what we do. That's why I've embarked on this. I want to tell you this. No business does a lot of things that doesn't make a profit. Okay? This is incredibly profitable for us because we get a lot of referrals, from being honest with you. But not only that. Let me tell you, I sleep really, really well at night that there are families out there that can say, my team and I help them to get out of a mortgage faster, or we are busy helping them get out of a mortgage faster, okay? So that's why we're not in conflict of interest with you. So here, what does our plan look like, okay? When you do a mortgage with us, we give you three written plans. So measure this up against the things I told you what a plan should have. Three written plans to be mortgage free faster. And we even review those plans with you when we review the mortgage in the process. Now, we do this for the clients that get mortgages through us. There's got to be some reality in that, right? And so we spend a lot of time on this stuff, okay? Number two, we check in with you once a year to say and to remind you to execute that plan, okay? Now, in case you don't want to do that, the support part I was talking about is when we check in with you, we will even offer to execute your plan on your behalf with your mortgage lender. So you could be like falling asleep. You just have to say, do it. Push the do it button on your computer, okay? And we do it for you. How's that? Okay? And then the fourth thing we do is you have no idea how many tools we are right now developing for our clients that will help them to become mortgage-free faster. So the moment that those are released, we will release them to you. They will be industry first. I can tell you that now. Industry first, phenomenal tools. We have two full-time software developer, front-end developer and back-end developer right on our team to develop these tools. I've invested an inordinate amount of money into this. I kind of don't even know if I'm a software company or a mortgage company anymore. But we believe that it's business is when business is good for people, people are good for the business. Absolutely. That's what we do. Well, you have been so great listening to me. What we ask in return from you is we humbly ask that you tell your story of winning to your friends, okay? So that they can have the opportunity to connect with us as well, and we can help them to become mortgage free as well, okay? If we do that, who knows? We may be able to climb the Mount Everest of debt, okay? And I'm gonna ask you one personal request. When you pay off your mortgage, I beg you, invite me to the mortgage burning party, okay? We'll make a big bonfire and we burn that sucker in your backyard and we'll have a great, great time doing that, okay? So thank you so much. Remember, we love to solve mortgage problems for people who care about their mortgage, okay? It sounds like an obvious statement, care about your mortgage. Try your best not to lead with the interest rate question. You watch the person at the bank sweat when you say to them, give me the most suitable mortgage, okay? And be like, what does that mean, okay? And then you will ask them to ask you questions and see how they do with that, okay? There should be phenomenal analysis in what lenders do for you or brokers do for you when you get a mortgage. You want to get the right mortgage, not the cheapest mortgage. It's never good for you. Nothing cheap has ever done the best, okay? I could talk the whole night here. Wow, look at that. It is 7:30, and I truly, truly want to thank you for taking the time out of your precious night to spend time with us. I have loved doing this. We will do this again, and we will also, in the new year, continue. It'll be the last Tuesday of every month. We will have a topic, and we will keep on doing that, okay? Thank you so much. You guys are amazing. Have yourself a phenomenal, phenomenal night. Take care.